So very good morning all of you. Now I come to my second video related on time series econometrics. The second video is on regression analysis, multiple regression analysis. So regression is an econometric technique for estimating the relationship among the variables. It helps to analyze how the typical value of the dependent variable changes when any one of the independent variables changes, while the other things remain constant, same. So linear regression estimates how much y changes when x changes 1 unit or 1%. The main purpose of linear regression analysis is to assess association between dependent and independent variables. So in my previous lecture classes, I have already discussed simple or bivariate regression model and their properties, how to estimate regression model, significance of constant term tensor coefficient, how we test each, and how we will compute them and interpret them, how we will forecast population regression line by using sample regression line, how we will analyze ANOVA and interpretation, etc. So I am not going to that part now. I will discuss here from multiple regression equations. Actually, in multiple regression equation, where the dependent variable is 1 and the number of independent variable is more than 1, it may be 2, 3, 4, 5 and so many. So more than 1 independent variable is usually necessary in order to predict a dependent variable accurately. So regression model with more than one independent variable are called multiple regression model. So it is clear. It is clear to all. So multiple regression involve the use of more than one independent variable to predict the changes of the dependent variable. Here each slope coefficient measures the rate of change in the mean value of dependent variable for a unit change in the value of one independent variable. So holding the values of other independent variables constant. Here one important thing is that how many independent variables should be included in the regression's equation. It is a questions to the researchers. How many independent variables should you select for your model? That depends on theory, assumptions, research objectives. So for an example, I am giving that in multiple regression equation, one is dependent variable and the right hand side are the independent variables. Now consider the practical example of multiple linear regression model. Suppose it is assumed that the COVID-19 impact of COVID-19 on economic growth. So this is the problem we want to examine, and thus we have considered relevant information regarding independent variable and it develop the model as under. Suppose GDP is a function of people attacked by COVID, it is a one independent variable. Death from COVID, independent variable number 2, death. Third, recover, independent variable number 3. And finally, affected, infected, independent variable 4. So there are 4 independent variables and 1 dependent variable. Here alpha value is the constant and you have to estimate both alpha and the slope coefficients. Here you have considered 4 independent variables and thus the slope coefficients are 4. By estimating the multiple regression equation, how? By applying ordinary least square technique. Here error or disturbance components, here error and disturbance components denoted by E represents the deviation of the response from the true relation. So there are unobservable random variables accounting for the effects of other factors on the response. So the errors are assumed to be independently and each is normally distributed with zero mean and unknown standard deviation. So here the regression coefficient together locate the regression functions are unknown. So how you will calculate the beta coefficient, how you will calculate the alpha coefficient and what is the test mechanism for significance. So I have already discussed in the when I have discussed about simple regressions or bivariate regressions models. Now I am not going to the that, I am not going to that part, but now come to inference for multiple regression model, inference for multiple regression model. Actually, the inference for multiple regression model is similar to that for simple regression equation. The least squares estimates of the model parameters, their estimated standard errors, t-statistic is used to examine the significance of individual terms in the regression model, and the f-statistic to check the overall significance of the multiple regression model. Now come to standard error of the estimate. I have already discussed in the previous lecture in my class. So again, the standard error of the estimate measures the amount of actual variation, actual values differ from the estimated values. Suppose y is the actual values, the difference between y minus predicted estimated values is the standard error. For relatively large samples, we would expect about 67% of the differences to be within standard error of 0, and about 95% of these differences to be within 2 standard error of 0. So how you will calculate standard error? Very simple. Standard error is equal to root over SSE mean represent residual sum of squares divided by n number of observations minus k number of independent variables minus 1 is equal to root over MSE. What is MSE? Mean square errors. So now come to significance of the multiple regression line. So the analysis of variance ANOVA table based on the decomposition of the total variation in Y. Total variation is denoted by SST. Into it, SSR, residual sum of square due to error term, and unexplained SSR due to regression, and unexplained SSE due to error term. So if you put this value into table, that looks like, suppose sources, first column is sources where the errors are arised. Two sources due to regressions and due to residuals. So if you add residuals errors and regressions errors, that is called total error. Okay. So SST is equal to SSR plus SSE. So due to regressions, that depends on k degrees of freedom, number of independent variable, and due to error, the degrees of freedom is n minus k minus 1, number of observations minus number of independent variable minus 1, and in total SST n minus 1, number of observations minus 1. If you have considered 10 observations, then your degrees of freedom will be n minus 1, 10 minus 1 is equal to 9. So now come to mean square. What due to regression? MSR, denoted as MSR, mean square error, is equal to SSR by k, regression error by the number of independent variables. Mean square of due to error term, MSE is equal to SSE divided by n minus k minus 1. And then how you will compute, calculate the significance level? So you have to use here F statistics. That indicates overall significance level. What is F statistic? How you will calculate F statistic? F statistic is equal to MSR by divided by MSE. Mean square regression, mean square error due to regressions, and by MSE, mean square error due to error term. So then you have to apply F test for the significance of the regressions under. What is the null hypothesis here you have to formulate? The null hypothesis H0 denoted as H0 is equal to beta 1. Actually, the above example here we have considered 4 independent variables. So there are four slope coefficients. So beta 1 is equal to beta 2 is equal to beta 3 is equal to beta 4 is equal to 0. What is the null and alternative hypothesis? Beta not equal to 0. So then you have to compute the F statistics with degree of freedom k, comma n minus k minus 1. You have choose any significance level, whether it may be 1% or it may be 5%. The rejection, if the calculated value of F is greater than the table value of F at chosen level of significance, you may reject the null hypothesis. So where the table value of S is the upper significance percentage point of an F distribution with k and n minus k1 degrees of freedom. So this is the procedure of overall significance of multiple regression equation. Now come to misuse of R square, goodness of it. I have already discussed the usefulness of R square, but today I will talk about misuse of R square. So in spite of many usefulness, you know that R square has many benefits. One must be cautious about its possible misuses also. In particular, it is to be remembered that it is dangerous to play the game of maximizing the value of R square. Some researchers do this by gradually increasing the number of independent variables in the model. So, however, in empirical research, quite often we come across a situation where the value of R square is high, but many of the estimated coefficients are statistically significant and or they have expected signs. Therefore, the researchers should be more concerned about the logical or theoretical relevance of the explanatory variables to the dependent variables and also their statistical significance. If in this process, a high value of R square is obtained, well and good. On the other hand, if R square value is low, very low, but the coefficient are statistically significant, that does not mean the model is bad. Particularly when a good number of estimated coefficients have expected signs and are statistically significant. So low R square value always bad, it is not correct. It is not correct. Now come to the assumptions of classical linear regressions model. What are the assumptions of CLRM? First assumption, the regression model is linear in the parameters. The regression model should correct variables without omitted variable bias and have correct functional form. Number two, the regressors are assumed to be fixed or non-stochastic in repeated sampling. This assumption may not be appropriate for all economic data. If independent variable and error term are uncorrelated, the classical results hold true asymptotically for large sample. Number three, given the values of x, independent variables, the expected or mean value of the error term is zero. The conditional expectations of the error term given the values of the independent variables is zero. Since the error term represents the influence of other factors that are not included in the regression equation and may be essentially random, it is very logical to assume that their mean or average value is zero. Number four, the variance of each error term denoted by e, small e, given the values of x, each constant or homeostatic. Number five, there is no correlation between two error terms, meaning that absence of autocorrelations problem. If there is autocorrelation, an increase in the error term in one period affects the error term in the next period. Number six, there are no perfect linear relationship among the independent variables. This is the assumption of multiple ticlonarity. I'll discuss later all those. Number 7, error term is not correlated with the independent variables. They are independently identically distributed. IID, independently identically distributed. Number 7, the regression model should be correctly specified. Alternatively, there is no specification bias or specification errors in the model. Used in empirical analysis, it is implicitly assumed that the number of observation n is greater than the number of independent number of estimated parameters. Number 8, all independent variables should be exogenous, which are defined outside of the model. And finally, although it is not a part of the CLRM, it is assumed that error term follows the normal distributions with zero mean and constant variance. Now come to what are the statistical properties of ordinary least square method. First property, linearity. The estimators are linear, that is, they are linear function of the dependent variables y. Number 2, unbiasedness. The estimators beta are unbiased, that is, in repeated application of the method, on average, the estimators approach their two values. Efficiency in the class of linear estimators, OLS, ordinary least squares, estimators have minimum variance. As a result, the true parameter values can be estimated with least possible uncertainty. An unbiased estimator with the least variance is called an efficient estimator. Number 4, normality. Very important is, normality is very important. So when you are dealing with data, your data must be normal. So the assumption of normality can be expressed in this way. Error term follows in bracket zero standard deviation, zero mean and constant standard deviations. So if the assumption of normality does not hold, then the OLS estimator remains the best linear unbiased estimator, best, blue, BLUE, that is, it has the minimum variance among all linear unbiased estimators. However, without normality, one cannot use the standard for the TNF distribution to perform statistical test. So the first criteria is to that your data will be normally distributed. If you not check these assumptions, your result will be unbiased. So what you have to do, you have to calculate skewness and kurtosis. So what is skewness? It is a measure for the degree of symmetry in the variable distribution. And what is kurtosis? It is a measure for the degree of thickness or flatness in the variable distribution. If your skewness value is 0 and kurtosis value is 3 respectively, then your distribution is normal. But the above assumptions can be tested jointly by using Jerkebera statistic, JB, developed by Jerkebera in 1981, which follows asymptotically a chi-square distribution, and it is popular to test for normality H under. What is the hypothesis here? Null hypothesis, data is normal, distribution is normal, alternative distribution is non-normal. How you will calculate? So JB statistic is equal to n means number of observation in third bracket, s square skewness square divided by 6 plus in the numerator k minus 3 kurtosis minus 3 whole square divided by 24. This is the formula, and it is very easy to calculate. First you have to find out the skewness and kurtosis value from your distributions, and then put the value in the formula, and you easily calculate the JB statistics. So here n is the number of observation, s is the skewness, k is the kurtosis. In general, when the values of s and k 0 and 3 respectively, your distribution is normal. But what is the decision rule is here? If the probability value of the computed JB statistics less than the chosen significance level, whether it may be 1% or it may be 5%, then reject H0, meaning that your distribution is not, your distribution is not normal, and vice versa. For example, suppose your computed JB statistic is 232.31 and the probability value is 0.000. It indicates that the probability value is less than 1%. If you compare 0.00 and 1%, then obviously 0.00 is less than 1% on 5% level. Then you reject the null hypothesis, meaning that your data is not, your distribution is not normal. So when your probability value is higher than 1% on 5%, 1% or 5%, then you accept the null hypothesis, meaning that your distribution is normal. Oh, thank you very much for being with me for a while, and good luck. In the next video, I will discuss about heteroscedasticity, various technique to detect heteroscedasticity, how will correct heteroscedasticity, remedial measures, and then multicollinearity, autocorrelation. I will discuss in my later video. So thank you very much.